All right. So we missed you all last week. Who was here last week? New Year's Day. Okay, a few people. Well, we missed you all, whether you were here or not. But thank you for releasing my family. We were with my dad's family celebrating, having our last Christmas celebration last week. So we appreciated the time away. So thank you for that. And thank you especially for all of you guys that, you know, work together to keep things flowing and keep all the details in order. We appreciate that. So we had about like half of us, which, wow, we're like really missing a whole lot of people. Anyway, yeah, we did. We prayed for Joe, right? At least, yeah, Joe and Josh, yeah, okay. And what? Be loud. Thank you. I appreciate that. If you weren't here physically last week, did you watch the video online or on the app? Okay. All right. This is not a reprimand. Just get in the habit of doing that so that you're not missing out and showing up, you know, the following week or whatever. Like, I don't know what's going on. I encourage you to watch that. Joe did an excellent job breaking down the vision for 2017 that we feel the Lord has given us for Live With Purpose Church. I was watching it and like I knew all the stuff, but I was still getting like pumped up about it listening to it. You know, it was like, yes, like let's go, God, make it happen. So anyway, Joe mentioned in his sermon last week the time that he and I spent back in December just praying and trying to get the heart of God, the mind of God for this year for us as a family, as a church. We spent the first part of that day, I don't know, I'm going to say a couple hours, up at Gateway House of Prayer in Ephrata. I don't know if anybody's familiar or has been. It was my first time there, and we don't have to sound so surprised, Nancy. I mean, I just, you know, I hadn't made it up there. wow, it's such an awesome place. Just a beautiful atmosphere. I mean, I think there were like two other people there, three other people, and one was serving, you know. And me and Joe, but a little bit of an aside, but I'm there like, wow, God, like, okay, you need to stir somebody's heart here in Conestoga to open a house of prayer out of Live With Purpose Church, maybe. But anyway, so while I'm there and I'm absorbing that atmosphere, and I'm just like, ah, thank you, God, like, I needed this time, you know, just like separated. I'm asking him, you know, okay, Lord, like, what's the plan? Like, what's the word? You know, like, I'm a leader in this church now. Like, I need, now it's up to me. Like, I'm used to, you know, showing up the first Sunday of the year and, okay, what's the word of the year? Like, let me have it, you know, and now it's like, okay, this is for real. And you know, we talk about the seven mountains a lot, and I just really felt like the Lord was highlighting the family mountain. Like, he was, like, shining a spotlight on the family mountain for me in my spirit. And I'm like, okay. I'm a really relational kind of guy. So it would be very easy for me to just be like, boom, got it. I know exactly what you're talking about, Lord. We're going to focus on relationships and fellowship, and we're just going to love everybody, and everything else is going to fall into place. That would be, like, super easy for me to jump to that conclusion based on that. But I was like, wait, hang on. Why? What is it about the family mountain that you want to point out to me right now? that is so important for this year. And so I wrote down in my little notebook what I felt like the Lord was showing me a picture of. And I'm not going to get like too detailed in the picture, but basically what I felt like he was saying is the family mountain is the like launch pad, if you will, for all of the other six mountains. Because when you think about it from a like a physical or natural standpoint and from a spiritual standpoint, the family is really the base. It's the thing that gives like a springboard for other things. You know, your kids grow up and you send them out into the world, right? And it provides support, covering, finances. It provides accountability. Sorry? No. Discipleship, yeah. No, it's cool. This is interactive. This is interactive. That's why, you know, I'm like, oh, two testimonies? Sweet. Like, you can take all my time with your testimonies. That's what we're about. Like, you guys getting out there and doing stuff. Like, it's not all about me and you guys just show up and I give you some information and then we move on with our lives. You know what I mean? Like, let me hear it. Anyway. Okay. So the family is the launch pad where all of the other mountains get reached from. Does that make sense? If you just say, I'm going to go reach the government mountain, and I'm going to do it. God called me to do it, and I'm just going to do it. You can do it, right? You can go anywhere and do anything. But if you're doing it Lone Ranger style, you're going to eventually pay some price for that. You know, I'm not saying like as in it's a sin to do it. I'm just saying you're going to be out there all by yourself. So the family becomes that place where you can get built up, empowered, discipled, resourced, sent out. If you get beat up, you can come back and be like, oh, I don't know what happened, it's awful. You know, get encouraged and okay, go do it again. You know, God's calling you. So that's where we're coming from today, is the foundation of family. Particularly a healthy church family, right? Because that's really what we want. I mean, we want healthy earthly families, but it's a healthy church family that really creates the, like we were talking about a couple weeks ago, the fire tornado. Did anybody remember the fire tornado? And really starts to like accelerate these things and launch these things out. So as we prepare at whatever point God chooses in the future to step into these other mountains, right? Mountains of cultural influence. And you're going to hear about this more and more, you know, as we go through the year. So just stick with us. Check out the website, 7culturalmountains.org or something like that. You can find it in like 2 seconds, I'm sure. But as we prepare to step into those, I'm telling you, it's going to be the family mountain that creates the base or the support for all those other mountains. So we got to be able to get this one right. So like I said, two types of families, earthly or physical families, spiritual families. It's not rocket science, guys. I mean, you know, I apologize if you feel like I'm talking down to you. Don't take it that way. I like to make sure I'm speaking in such a way that everyone can track with me. I'm not so much with like the high-minded stuff where you're like, you know, got to spend 20 minutes just trying to figure it out. Today in particular, though, I want to focus on the earthly family, physical family. So what I want you guys to be doing as we go through this is just be praying and asking the Lord these three questions. What is in this for me as an individual, right? What is in this for my family? And what is my role in this spiritual family? Live with Purpose Church. Or if you're watching online and you're from a different church, what's your role in that church? So, family is special. Can I get an amen?
Amen?
Family is special. Family is special because they're the ones that we should be able to count on the most. Family is special because they're the ones we should be able to go to when we're hurt or when we're hurting. Right? It's not just little kids that need a place where they can go when they're hurt or hurting. Family is special because they're the ones we should be able to be with, to be present with. And in the context of a family home, home is a place where we should be able to be real with each other. Home is a place where we can exercise things, we can step up and step out, and it's a safe environment. You know? I'm going to put Travis on the spot. Travis doesn't particularly like to speak in front of people, especially with a microphone in his hand. But he's doing it, and doesn't he do a great job? Praise the Lord. It's a safe environment where he can practice things, where we can all practice things and grow and learn. Amen? Home should be a place where we can, because it's a safe environment, where we can make mistakes, but instead of being hammered about it, we can be encouraged to keep trying. Right? Home should be a place where we can always come back and be restored. Think about the prodigal son, right? You can always come home. If it was your kid, right? It almost wouldn't matter to you what they'd have done. You would just want them to come back, right? Like, just come back. And that's what home should be. Home should be the place we go to get fed, cleaned up, fixed up, built up, and sent back out. Right? Because if you have grown kids, you can't stay here anymore. You come back and eat, right? You come back and we'll have a good time, but you're not staying here. Get back out there. Do what God designed you to do. But how many of us know that our earthly families don't always work like that? You don't have to raise your hand if your family isn't as idyllic as all of those things. I don't know why I keep moving this around. So, our earthly families don't always work out exactly the way God intended them to. Kids with Purpose, we're talking about, we're kind of in the story of Adam and Eve, right? Don't go into that. Yeah, we're talking about Adam and Eve. That didn't really work out the way God wanted it to, right? Like, can you, anything? Yeah? It's cool. I'm just going to keep picking on you guys. I pick on you because I love you. Sometimes these earthly families let us down. Sometimes we feel like we can't count on our earthly families like we should be able to. Sometimes our earthly families aren't there for us when we're hurting. Sometimes our earthly families aren't physically present with us. Sometimes that's by choice. Sometimes it's through death. Sometimes other circumstances. But sometimes our earthly families are not physically present with us like we would like them to be. Sometimes home is not a safe place, whether physically or emotionally. Sometimes home is not a safe place where we can go and be open and honest. You know? Sometimes home is not a place where we feel like we can make mistakes. So, like I said, I mean, we'll be talking about both types of families, physical family, spiritual family. I actually have two back-to-back Sundays, so it's the other reason I wasn't too worried about time, because I'm like, oh, I can just roll that into next week. But like I said, today we want to focus on the physical family, okay? And we can see all through the Bible examples of how God uses the earthly physical family, the family unit, to accomplish his plans and purposes on the earth. Can I get any head nods? Anybody, you're starting to think of, okay, yeah, I can think of some families. Let's go through it real quick. Adam and Eve started a family outside of the Garden of Eden. A family. Noah and his family replenished the earth after the flood. God speaks to Abram, who God later called Abraham, and says that all the families on the earth will be blessed through you. All the families. Isaac is the promised child of Abraham and Sarah. And then Isaac and Rebekah start their family by having Esau and Jacob. Okay? And it's Jacob and his family who enter Egypt as part of God's plan to birth an entire nation. Are you with me? God uses earthly families for his plans and purposes. Amen. So these family connections go on and on all throughout Scripture, including the birth of Jesus. There's family ties that link with Jesus. And that's in Scripture. You can look it up. Google it. No, I'm just kidding. So I want to look at one particular family in Scripture that we're going to use as our example for today, the family of Jacob. So if you turn in your Bible, there's Bibles at the end of the pew if you don't have one, or pop open your Bible app, whatever you prefer to use. And we're going to go to Genesis chapter 37. Genesis chapter 37. That is the first book of the Bible. Just in case you were looking for it. No problem. Genesis 37, verses 2 through 4. You have that one on? Yep, he's got it. All right. So, it says, this is the account of Jacob and his family. When Joseph was 17 years old, he often tended his father's flocks. He worked for his half-brothers, the sons of his father's wives, Bilhah and Zilpah. But Joseph reported to his father some of the bad things his brothers were doing. Jacob loved Joseph more than any of his other children because Joseph had been born to him in his old age. So one day, Jacob had a special gift made for Joseph, a beautiful robe. But his brothers, that's Joseph's brothers, hated Joseph because their father loved him more than the rest of them. They couldn't say a kind word to him. So, I think we can see that some of these family dynamics here in Jacob's family, the family that God plants into Egypt to birth an entire nation of God's chosen people, is not exactly perfect. Can you see that? Just in those two verses. Two verses. In verse 2 alone, can you go back to verse 2, please? In verse 2 alone, we learn some of how dysfunctional Jacob's family is. I mean, we laugh about it. It's not really funny. Joseph was 17 years old, and he was working for four of his older brothers. Joseph had mainly older brothers. Are you clear on that? And he's working for four of his older brothers. So there's a decent age gap between them, right? They're old enough to have their own flocks and businesses, and Joseph works for them. Now, the brothers Joseph is working for, this is really interesting. Those four brothers were born to Jacob's concubines, Bilhah and Zilpah, only became his wives. They started out as his wives' servants. They only became his wives because his wives were in a childbirthing battle between each other, right? A competition to see who could have the most children. Leah and Rachel are their names. And you can read more about that on your own time, Genesis 29 and 30. But anyway, a little bit of an aside there, but I thought that was interesting. Joseph's working for four of his older brothers that came from not his father's original wives, but the wives that were given to him by his wives so that they could have more kids. I don't know. It just sounds way too complicated to me. All right, also in verse 2. We're still just in verse 2 here, and we're still talking about Jacob's messed up family. It says Joseph was a tattletale. 17 years old, and he's a little tattletale. He's reporting to his dad some of the bad things his older brothers were doing. Right? Now we go to verse 3 and 4. Oh, well, you got... Oh, sorry. Verse 3 and 4, we learn even more, right? Jacob loved Joseph more than the others. And it wasn't like nobody knew about it. It was like blatantly obvious to everyone that he favored Joseph. Now, even if you're pretty like emotionally not sensitive, an emotionally non-sensitive person, you can probably still understand the like hurt of knowing that your parents favor one of your siblings over everyone else. Like, you just don't do that as a parent. But Jacob did. What else do we learn? We learn in verse 3 and 4 that Joseph's brothers hated him. They didn't just he's not my favorite. No, they hated him, and they couldn't say a kind word about him. Now, like I said, Joseph had mostly older brothers. He actually had 10 older brothers, right? Because the youngest was Benjamin, and then Joseph, and then on up from there. 10 older brothers that couldn't say a kind word to him. And 4 of them he works for. I don't know. I mean, can you imagine? Can you imagine what life must have been like for Joseph in that family environment? Does that feel like a safe place or a place where he can be free to make a mistake and not get judged for it? You know, like, whew, talk about stressful. You kids, where are kids, my kids at? I don't know, my kids are like, oh, there's a couple. If you've got brothers and sisters, even if you just have one brother or sister, I'm sure they only have nice things to say about you, right? All the time. What? Yeah? The Yoder family, they're always saying kind things to each other. How about you guys back there? No? Wow, that's really surprising. No, I'm just kidding. It's really not surprising, right? But can you imagine what it would feel like to live in a home, kids, who's still talking to you, where none of your brothers or sisters have anything even remotely nice to say to you? In fact, they openly hate you. Can you imagine? Hopefully you can't imagine, because you have no concept of what that would feel like. Let's say that we don't know what that would be like. But for us as adults, can you imagine what it would be like? Let's say it's at work, right? And you're surrounded all day, every day, by people who can't even say one kind thing to you about anything. Is that a place you'd want to go back to every day? This is Jacob's family. Welcome to Jacob's family. So I think, like I said, I think we can agree Jacob's family is far from perfect, right? So let's just wipe that notion right off the board that God uses. God looks for perfect families that he can use to accomplish his purposes on earth. Right? Because we talked about at the beginning that God uses earthly families to accomplish his purposes on earth. Still with me on that? So you can get rid of any notion that you might have had that it requires a perfect family or a perfect family history in order for your family to be used by God. Are we all on the same page with that?
Amen.
I don't want to move on until I'm sure that everybody's with me on that, because that's very critical. Now, we're going to skip ahead to Genesis 49. You don't have to turn there. It's kind of long. But in Genesis 49, it's the end of Jacob's life. So they're all there in Egypt. They're all together. Jacob is dying. He calls all 12 of his sons together because he's going to speak to them his final words over them. And what I want you to realize, I mean, we're skipping pretty far ahead here from where we were. The entire Joseph story has already taken place, right? So most of you probably know the story of Joseph. Again, just for anyone, I'm sure you're all very well versed, anyone who might be watching it online, we'll run through it real quick. So what has happened since Joseph was 17? Joseph's older brothers have plotted to kill him, but Reuben, the oldest, convinces them just to throw him into a dry cistern instead. Now, if you're not familiar, a cistern is just like a water storage tank. So it's not a well. Sometimes we say they threw him in a well. Anyway, again, that's an aside. So then Judah suggests that they sell Joseph as a slave to some traders passing by, which they do, right? Then all of Joseph's brothers agree to lie to their father Jacob about what they just did to Joseph, which they do, and he believes the lie, which he had no reason not to. Meanwhile, Joseph is sold as a slave into Egypt, and he has many ups and downs while he's living there, but he maintains his personal testimony through it all, and God blesses everything that he does. Everything that Joseph puts his hands to is blessed. I think about Mel's message about Obed-Edom, you know, catalyst. Like, everybody noticed that Joseph was was blessed in everything that he did. And so, ultimately, Joseph is put in charge of all of Egypt and stewards the land through 7 years of total barrenness and 7 years of complete fruitfulness, excessive harvest, and then 7 years of complete barrenness, right? Now, within the first 1 to 2 years of that famine, of the barren years, that's where Jacob is sending his older sons to Egypt to buy food. He sends them twice, and the second time they're there, Joseph reveals his true identity to his brothers, right? Also, something that has happened since Joseph was 17 and now Jacob is ready to die, Joseph's brothers beg for forgiveness for what they did to him all those years ago. And by God's grace, Joseph is able to forgive them. That's one of the most incredible parts of the Joseph story for me, right? Now, we're still talking about family. Everybody still with me? I am going somewhere, so just hang in there a little bit longer. So they beg for his forgiveness, and as I was preparing this, I wrote it down because it just hit me like so hard. I don't know if it's people in this room now or people watching this later on or whatever, but there are people hearing this who need to go back to their brothers or sisters or parents or somebody from your past and beg for their forgiveness for something that happened between you. I don't know. The Lord didn't give me any details or anything. I'm just putting that out there for you. Don't raise your hand. Just make a note if that hits your spirit and get it done. Be reconciled. Amen? Okay, continuing. Joseph then explains to his brothers that the famine will last 5 more years as part of God's plan and purpose, and he instructs them to relocate their entire, say it with me, family. One more time. Family to Egypt so that they can survive. Right? Jacob is now in Egypt. The first time Jacob speaks to Pharaoh, he's 130 years old. And when he dies, he's 147. So Joseph was 17 at the beginning of our story. Jacob and his family have lived in Egypt for 17 years. And now Jacob is ready to pass away. And he's prepared to prophesy over each one of his 12 sons. That's what the Bible says. He was ready at 147 years old to speak a word of the Lord over each one of his 12 sons. Now, maybe he spoke a word over his daughters too, and just nobody felt the need to record it. I don't know. But anyway, I look at that and I'm like, wow. I have 4 kids, and sometimes I feel like I'm not doing a great job just knowing them or being able to speak over them, you know. And here's Jacob. He's got 3 times the number of sons that I have, and he's ready, man. Let that be a challenge for all of us, that we would be prepared to prophesy the word of the Lord over our kids and not save it until the day before we're going to die. Amen? All right. Why? Why is it important that Jacob would prophesy over his kids? Why is it important that we should speak the word of the Lord over our kids? Why is it important that we should be able to discern what the Lord is saying to our kids? Shouldn't they just work that out for themselves? Right? I mean, they're able to, we talk about all the time, right? There's no junior Holy Spirit. Or if you have grown kids, you know, they're adults. They can hear from God themselves, right? Why? Why does it matter that a parent would do it? And this is why, because family, right? Family provides context for culture. It provides context for kids to understand who they are, how God has built them, and what their purpose is in the world. Right? You're not just going to leave them out there hanging to figure it out on their own. That's why it's important. If your child comes to you and tells you about something or about someone, and they explain to you how they responded or how they felt or whatever, you have this amazing opportunity in front of you as a parent at that moment, right? Or grandparent. I'm not a grandparent yet, so I don't speak in grandparent terms yet. But you have an opportunity to help them understand why they are the way they are. Or why they do what they do, or why they feel the way they feel about certain things, right? You as a parent, or the family unit, you're creating a context for them, you're helping them develop a context for what God is doing through them as an individual. So by being able to help them discern those spiritual gifts and abilities, right, you're helping them to sort of process and make sense of what is sometimes an incredibly complicated world that they live in. Anybody else feel like the world is getting more complicated as time goes by? I don't think it's getting simpler, you know, and I think our kids would agree with that, not that they know what it was like, but so just quick example to make it really, really practical. If your son or daughter, shares something with you that they're dealing with, you want to be able to respond with something along the lines of, I can understand why you did that, or I can understand why you felt that way, because you have this, you know, fill in the blank, spiritual gift, you know, or God has given you this ability. That's why you respond to certain things this way. Or to make it a little more specific, I can understand why you felt that way because you have a discerning spirit, right? And you're sensitive to the spiritual atmosphere around you. By talking to our kids that way, and it's not just like, you know, I should be doing this, so let me try to come up with something quick, you know, to have to say to them. No, like, we got to be praying about this and prepared. You got to be paying enough attention to your kids to be prepared to deliver, or grandkids, to be able to deliver that word in season at that moment. So, right, we're going to help them develop context for the culture around them. By doing this, we're empowering them to walk out the purposes of God for their lives on a daily basis, right? Because we can't hover over them constantly, you know, they're not going to want to hold our hands all the time, right? Oh, man. And we're helping them to build confidence in who they are. Now, if you weren't out with us on Thursday night, we gave the first viewing of our first in-house video testimony, sort of, from Irie, who is developing a devotional for kids called Who You Are. I was going to play the video for you this morning, but things are not cooperating so much, and so I passed on that. But anyway, we're helping them to be confident in who they are, who God has made them to be. Right? Okay. So I gotta skip a little bit here. On your own, take a look at Genesis 49, verses 1 through 28, where you can read the words that Jacob spoke over each one of his 12 sons, like we talked about. And what I want you to take away from that as you're reading it is they were not perfect. Not all of the words that Jacob spoke over his sons were like words of blessing and like, you're going to be awesome. You know, like, I don't know. I kind of want to go through it just because I think it's very interesting. So let's do it quick. Reuben, the oldest, Jacob said he's as unruly as a flood. Number two and number three, Simeon and Levi, he says they're violent and angry. Now I'm just like consolidating everything. He's got lots of flowery language in there to, you know, put a lot more detail to it. Violent and angry. Number four, Judah is to be a ruler like a lion, and who dares to disturb him? Number five, Zebulun is to be a traitor. Six, Issachar is a hard worker. So there's a positive one. Number six, you know. Number seven, Dan is a dangerous snake. Number eight, Gad is a fighter and he's set on revenge. Number nine, Asher is a chef. So that's pretty, you know, it's not so bad. Number 10, Naphtali is beautiful and free. Number 11, Joseph is strengthened by God and a prince among his brothers. And then number 12, Benjamin is a ravenous wolf to his enemies. Now, at least he's only like that to his enemies, but, you know, still a bit of a frightening character, maybe. So, that's what I want to highlight is, you know, these are the 12 families that God blesses in Egypt and sends out. Well, number one, he causes them to prosper in Egypt, right? They go in as a family. They come out a nation. And these are the 12 families that God eventually brings out of Egypt and puts into the promised land. They're as unruly as a flood. They're violent and angry. You know, the whole list. It's right there. So why? Why am I taking time to go through all of this? Why are we talking about all of these little details of one family from the Old Testament, even? Right? What's the point? I'm taking time to mention all of this in detail to highlight these couple things. So if you haven't felt interested in taking any notes at all, that's fine. But take note of these couple things. You got the, oh, that shouldn't have the background. Here we go. This is the point, guys. The promise and the calling of God for you and your family far outweighs all of the imperfections that you see in your family. Look at Jacob and his family. Right? They weren't perfect. Jacob even prophesied about how imperfect they were before he died. And yet God still was faithful to his call and his promise for their 12 families. Are you with me? The foundation of the family. Also, playing off of that, God isn't looking for perfect people that are good enough for him to use, right? He's not surveying the earth looking for perfection so that he can hopefully find somebody that he can use. He's looking for people who are willing to surrender to his will and to his way, and he works through you. Right? Why do we need the blood of Jesus? Because we can't be perfect on our own. You can't stand before God on your own and pass his judgment. You can't. That's why we need Jesus. That's why we need his blood to cover us, so that when we stand before him, we stand forgiven, free, blameless. The list of adjectives stretches on of what Jesus has done for us, what we couldn't do ourselves. He's looking for people who will allow themselves to be transformed into the image of Christ through their obedience to his word and his spirit. And thank you, Sandra, for sharing your word this morning. God's looking. He's looking. He's calling. But he's not filtering you out if you or your family history has some blemish in it. Don't give up on God using you just because of imperfections that you see. Don't let your children's imperfections, or maybe even your perceived imperfections, because sometimes as parents we get a little uptight about every little thing. Don't let that limit how God is going to use them or use your family. Don't let your family's imperfections, whether it's your immediate family, your extended family, don't let that limit you. Don't let that be, well, I can't do that. Everybody knows my family, you know, like, everybody knows so-and-so, like, don't let your church's imperfections stop you from allowing God to work through you there. Just like with our earthly families, it's real easy to be keenly aware of our church family's imperfections and be like, you know, I see this and I see that. And now, I mean, obviously we have to use wisdom and discernment, right? Like, you know, I'm not saying be somewhere where it's unhealthy and detrimental to you and your family, but don't let the little things limit how God wants to use you. All right, we'll wrap it up. So, recap. I know it wasn't complicated, but recap, just to make sure we're good, right? The family mountain, looking at the seven mountains of cultural influence, the family mountain is going to be the thing that we launch people out of into the other mountains. You guys with me on that? Okay. We're going to continue to talk about how our earthly families are going to be used by God. Next week, we're going to transition into how this spiritual family is going to be used by God, and how we can all play a part in that. You know, hopefully you already know some of your role in that. But we'll talk about that some more. So let's pray. Let's pray. I want to just pray like a general blessing over all of you guys before we go. And if, as always, you know, if you want specific prayer for anything, come see me. We will need some help tearing things down and whatnot, but we'll get it. If you need prayer, that's more important. We'll also be over at Underground, like Travis mentioned, so you're welcome to join us over there and we can continue the conversation. Amen. Father, thank you so much that you work through our imperfect families. You take our broken lives and you use us, like Travis talked about earlier, Lord. You use us even though we don't have it all together, we don't have it all figured out. Lord, I thank you that you give us opportunities to step out in faith and to be a blessing into other people's lives. And Lord, I bless each one of these earthly families that is represented here today with your blessings, God. Holy Spirit, I ask that you would give wisdom and discernment to each parent, grandparent. Lord, that they would be able to speak your word over their children, their grandchildren. Lord, whether they're natural children or adopted or spiritual children, Lord, it goes so far beyond biological children, Lord. You work and adopt in everyone, Lord. You want everyone. Lord, give them your words that they can be a blessing to their children, to their grandchildren, to their spiritual children, Lord. That you would use them, their lives, their families, generations, Lord, for the building up, the equipping, the sending out of workers, Lord. It's all for you and for your kingdom, for your glory and your honor. Lord, we thank you, we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I love you guys. Thank you. Go in peace.